Good morning, everyone. So, in this module, we have studied the League of Nations and why it was more or less useless. Today, we're discussing the last nail in the coffin of this institution, the Italian invasion of Ethiopia in 1935. Small note, we'll use the words Ethiopia and Abyssinia interchangeably. They are the same thing. At one time, you will see Ethiopia, at another time, you will see Abyssinia. There is no reason why I should choose either word, so I will use them both. So, this will be a two-part lesson, one today and the next one on Friday. Today we will look at the events that led to the invasion and at why the League of Nations did not intervene. In particular, we'll look at the following points. The story so far, a recap of what we said so far about the League of Nations. Then we'll look at Italy and Ethiopia and at the troubled relationship in the 19th and 20th century. We will then look at the Walwal incident, at the reactions to this incident and its consequences, and finally at the beginning of the invasion. There will also be a model answer at the end of this video. So, the story so far. In this module, as we said, we have studied how the League of Nations was born as a ray of hope after 4 years of the most devastating conflict the world had ever seen. A war that had shaken up the very foundations of European society, destroying centuries-old empires like the Ottomans or the Austrians, and bringing to the fore new and powerful actors like the United States, Japan or the Soviet Union. We've also seen how the League of Nations kept disappointing whoever trusted it to carry out its high-minded mission of preserving peace, legality and prosperity across the globe. Now, its faults were many. The Corfu incident showed us, for example, that since the very beginning in 1923, the League of Nations was unable to react appropriately to acts of international bullying, as fascist Italy's bombing and occupation of the Greek island of Corfu went unpunished, and the British and French governments were forced to deal with Mussolini as individual countries rather than as representatives of the League. Then we looked at the Treaty of Locarno and at the Kellogg-Briand Pact, which tried to establish a new international order by solving the territorial controversy between Germany and France. It was a step towards collective security, which, once again, was done not by the League of Nations, but by a few countries outside its structure. Yet, ensuring collective security was a part of the very essence of the League, and being sidelined in a similar agreement was clearly not a good sign for its authoritativeness. Finally, we explored how ineffective the League could be when tasked with acts of blatantly illegal international aggression like the Japanese invasion of Manchuria. However, Manchuria and Japan were on the other side of the world, and sending troops in those areas could prove very difficult. In the next crisis faced by the League, a European state would invade an African country, Ethiopia or Abyssinia, that was literally surrounded by French and British colonies. There is a map in the transcript. And the only way to reach those areas was to pass through a strategic waterway under joint British and French control. So, if Britain and France really wanted to do something, they could have done that very easily. We are talking, of course, about the Italian invasion of Ethiopia when, to the surprise of exactly no one, the League reacted by doing absolutely nothing. By now, we are... Let me get a glass of water. By now, we are sort of familiar with Italy and its fascist regime. In 1922, the boot-shaped country we all know and love came under the rule of an authoritarian fascist dictator, Benito Mussolini. Under the laughable pretense of rebuilding the Roman Empire, which was clearly a propaganda move, I don't think he even believed it himself, his foreign policy had one main aim: turn Italy into a military power able to rival France and Britain. The country was, for European standards, however, pretty underdeveloped. It was still a very much agrarian country with a lot of farmers rather than industrial labourers, to simplify it very much. But Mussolini still needed some kind of military victory if he wanted to confirm his image as the invincible leader to the eyes of the national and international public opinion. To achieve such a victory, he put his eyes on the lands of Ethiopia, also known as Abyssinia, an African country that Italy had already tried to invade in the 1890s, with disastrous and humiliating results for the Italian army, which was the only European army unable to defeat an African nation. Ethiopia was not just any African nation, it had an incredibly long history, it was one of the major centers of ancient civilization in Africa, but still it was a humiliating defeat, especially if seen with the eyes of 19th century colonialism. So Ethiopia had defeated Italy in a previous war, it was not occupied by any other European power, and very importantly, it also bordered another East African colony of Italy, Eritrea. It was therefore a perfect target, and by 1934, Mussolini had begun assembling troops at the border, with obvious intentions. We should not get too caught up, however, in the definition of border. I mean, he amassed troops at the border, it implies that there was a line in the sand, and that on the one side you got the Italian colonies, and on the other side you got Ethiopia. Not really. Those areas did not really have very well defined and controlled borders, not by modern standards. It was mostly just wide desert and mountains. The Italian army took advantage of this fact and began establishing some advanced position well inside Abyssinian territory. There is a map in the transcript as well. One such basis was the oasis of Walwal, which soon became a fortified point garrisoned by about 300 local African troops, the Askari. Don't know if they were Askari or if they were another kind of colonial troops, but they were essentially African soldiers recruited in those areas who were under the command of Italian officers. The Ethiopians knew that Italy had an invasion in mind, because obviously, and sent some troops to check the situation, accompanied by some British soldiers that wanted to clarify whether Italian soldiers were or not beyond the borders. Tensions between these two groups, the Ethiopian soldiers and the Italian soldiers around this oasis fort, rose very rapidly, and as soon as the British troops left, because they didn't want to get involved in what was clearly going to turn into a shootout, well, the Ethiopians and Italians began shooting each other. It did turn into a shootout, which caused the death of 110 Ethiopian soldiers and of around 50 Italian colonial troops. Mussolini, now that there had been a kerfuffle and that people had been shooting each other, now he had an excuse to invade Ethiopia, finally, and he began shipping over even more troops, even more supplies, and started preparing for a full-scale invasion. Now, the Emperor of Ethiopia, Haile Selassie, and now we're talking about the reactions and the consequences to this incident, immediately appealed to the League for help. Negotiates and talks began almost immediately. But while the Italians were supposedly dealing with the League in order to find a diplomatic solution, in reality, they kept sending weapons and troops to the borders with Ethiopia. Meanwhile, the French and British governments had realized that these repeated breaches of international law and the complete lack of action by the League of Nations made them look weak and reduced their influence on the world stage. They looked weak because they were not doing what they were supposed to do. Furthermore, it was not just looking weak and incompetent to other countries. The British and French government were aware that the public opinion in their own countries, which were parliamentary democracies, looked favourably at an armed intervention against the fascists in Ethiopia, and therefore they felt the need to look tough in speeches and proclaims in order to not be defeated in the upcoming elections. So they started decrying the fascist invasion as illegal, they started waving around flags and sabres, but the negotiates and the talks and these speeches went on for 8 months, and again, to the surprise of no one, nothing was done, even though all the supplies, weapons and troops sent by Italy to Ethiopia had to pass through the Suez Canal, which was the only way, the only access from the Mediterranean into Africa, and also under joint British and French control, which meant that Britain and France, if they meant to, could shut it down at any time, could prevent the passage of Italian ships, if they really seriously meant to punish Italy for that. But in 8 months, they did absolutely nothing. The reason was simple. Mussolini had not yet allied himself with Adolf Hitler. We haven't talked too much about Hitler yet, but trust me, he will receive his fair share of attention in the next term when we discuss the actual origins of World War II. Instead, the Italian dictator was seen as the best ally to contrast Hitler's expansionism. He was not an ally of Hitler yet. That is important to remember. Mussolini even signed, together with Britain and France, the Pact of Stresa. Don't know how to pronounce it correctly. A joint declaration that condemned Hitler's expansionism and rearmament. Because remember, the Treaty of Versailles forbid, among the many other things that it forbid the German army from rearming itself, from Germany from rebuilding a strong army. Hitler ignored that, started rebuilding an army, and the three powers essentially signed the joint declaration telling him, please stop doing that, you're causing another world war and we don't want that. So the two powers considered Mussolini as a potential ally against Hitler. So to keep Mussolini on the good side, nothing was done during this initial phase of the Ethiopian crisis. Eventually, after all was said and done, and as we already mentioned, a lot was said but very little was done, the Italians launched their offensive against Ethiopia, attacking from both Eritrea and Italian Somaliland in a pincer movement. We will see in our next lesson how that worked out for Italy, Britain and France, and of course for the Ethiopians themselves. Spoiler alert, sanctions are coming. So, those were the facts. Now I'll read the model answer, and I'm looking forward to read what you can write. Now, model answer. The Italian invasion of Ethiopia in 1935 was the final coffin in the nail of the League of Nations, as it showed its complete inability to deal with an illegal war. It also showed that Britain and France were not strong or authoritative enough to defend the interests of the League against the many threats that it was facing. Fascist Italy decided to invade Ethiopia in order to increase its own prestige and obtain revenge for the disastrous colonial defeats of the 1890s. Furthermore, Mussolini's leadership in Italy needed military victories in order to look vindicated in the eyes of the Italian people. And Ethiopia, being a weak and underdeveloped country bordering the Italian colony of Eritrea, was an ideal target. Tensions between the two countries continued to grow until in December 1934 there was a confrontation between Italian and Ethiopian troops at the Walwal Oasis, a location within Ethiopia where the Italian army had built a fort. Mussolini used this incident, which caused the lives of 50 colonial soldiers, as an excuse to gather his troops. On the other hand, the Ethiopian Emperor Haile Selassie decided to appeal to the League of Nations asking for help. While the British and French politicians, who wanted to be re-elected, condemned the incident and talked a lot about taking actions against the fascist invasion of Ethiopia, they spent 8 months talking and negotiating but doing very little to actually solve the situation. This inaction was caused by the belief that Mussolini would help them against Adolf Hitler's Germany, which was starting to look more aggressive every day. In fact, Mussolini had signed the Stresa Pact in 1935, which protested against Germany's rearmament, and promised to react to further breaches of the Treaty of Versailles. Nevertheless, encouraged by the lack of initiative shown by the French and the British leaders of the League of Nations, in October 1935 Mussolini launched his invasion of Ethiopia, which was over by March 1936. Next time we will see what happens next. Those were the facts, that was the model answer, and looking forward to read what you can write. See you next time.